Hey everyone, I'm Ben Norton of Multipolarista, and I'm very happy to announce the beginning of a series that I am co-hosting with a friend of the show named Aaron Good. Aaron is a historian and a scholar. He has a PhD in political science, and he published a book this 2022 called American Exception, Empire, and the Deep State. And what we're doing in this series is a history of the U.S. empire based on his book. And the series is called Empire and the Deep State. And I thought this was important because here at Multipolarista, I do a lot of journalistic coverage of what's happening today in contemporary politics in the U.S. empire, the decline of the unipolar empire created by the United States, the rise of this multipolar world. Well, in order to understand U.S. imperialism and the history of the U.S. empire, I think it's important to theoretically and historically root our knowledge in the work of historians like Aaron Good. So in this series, we're going to talk about how the U.S. empire was created, how the U.S. empire has always been rooted in criminality and lawlessness, and the important role of big business interests of large corporations and bankers and capitalists in driving the interests of the U.S. empire, and how capitalism is so directly linked to imperialism. So this is the series Empire and the Deep State. This is part one. We're going to be exploring the very important topics that helped give rise to the U.S. empire. And in this first episode, we're going to have a very basic overview of what the U.S. empire is, what the deep state is, and of course, how the deep state represents these corporate interests, these capitalist interests, and the criminality that the U.S. empire uses to maintain its hegemony around the world. So without further ado, this is part one of a lengthy series I'll be doing with dozens of episodes with friend of the show, Aaron Good, and also his producer and co-host, Seamus McGuinness. Thanks for watching or listening.
So it begins the epic, at least by my standards, podcast series on my book, American Exception, Empire in the Deep State. I am joined by Ben Norton and series producer Seamus McGuinness. And this is a joint American Exception and Multipolarista production. Ben, it's great to have you here.
Yeah, glad to be here, Aaron. I'm excited for the series. It's going to be good.
And Seamus, always awesome to work with you. And I'm really glad that you're on board with us for this series.
Great to be here.
So I'm going to, I'm going to kick this off to you guys to guide this conversation. We've all read the book, and I wrote the book, and I reread it again. And so we're all pretty steeped in this at this point. Ask me anything.
All right. So just kind of broadly in terms of your background, how'd you end up going from being a left liberal Democrat to being a radical critic of the U.S. empire with this book and your dissertation?
Well, I grew up in a political household, and I was, as you point out, kind of a left liberal Democrat, conventional, but more critical of foreign policy. So my mom was a protest of the Vietnam War, and I knew about what Reagan was up to in the 80s with Iran-Contra. My mom worked for a congressman during that time period. So I knew a bit about the dark side of U.S. foreign policy, and my earliest political memories are Ronald Reagan in the White House, and that he was not a good guy. And so I think that that was a good place to start from. I majored in political science in college and then didn't really want to go into politics. Instead, I went to Taiwan to teach English for a year. And graduating, it was a weird time. I graduated in 2000, and this was right at the height of American kind of unreality about the world. The Cold War had ended. America was great. We were involved in really silly political things like the Lewinsky scandal, and those were like the biggest issues at the time on the surface for us. So I went to Taiwan, and when I came back, 9/11 happened. And I kind of worked a bunch of different jobs over the when I came back in the early 2000s, eventually worked on a Democratic campaign in 2004, and did some teaching and other jobs before 2008 when I worked for the Obama campaign. And that involved moving to Missouri and working on his campaign staff, working crazy hours for low money. But I thought it was worth it because I thought Obama would be able to correct the crimes of the Bush administration. And really, that the U.S. imperialism of the Bush era was so abhorrent that it seemed that Obama had to change it. And after all, he was campaigning on change. And so you would expect him to try to change some things if that was going to be his whole slogan. And then when he didn't, reality set in, and I was left very disillusioned, especially after the coup in Honduras, after the bailouts of Wall Street and the mass evictions. That was the way that Obama dealt with the financial crisis. And Libya also was really terrible. And around that same time, I heard Oliver Stone talking about JFK and the Unspeakable. And so I ordered the book because I remembered seeing the film JFK. And I remembered having conversations with people, even on the campaign, job, about people who've been old Democratic people. And they were saying, you like Obama, we root for him, but man, we worry, is he going to get assassinated if he tries to do anything? And I thought, that's plausible, because I remembered Bobby Kennedy, and I don't remember him, wasn't alive, but John Kennedy, Robert Kennedy, what happened in the 60s, and what Oliver Stone wrote about, or said in the movie JFK, which was more accurate than people want to give him credit for. So I ordered the book, JFK and the Unspeakable by James Douglas, and I read it, and it offered such a big critique of U.S. foreign policy and the national security state that it made me just look more into the clandestine realm of U.S. foreign policy. Because if democracy doesn't work, if going out and voting for people and campaigning for people doesn't really work, then it suggests that there's a higher power at work. And the Kennedy assassination, because it involves the murder of a public official in broad daylight, democratically elected official, it suggests that there's a veto power and kind of a darker force in politics. And that darker force seems to be what was represented by Obama's right-wing turn, and that it was, I'm not trying to say it's just that it's personified with Obama at all, because it's not. So it made me want to look into these structures in the American system. I found the work of Lance DeHaven Smith, a political scientist at Florida State University, who'd written about state crimes against democracy. And we hit it off immediately. I messaged him, I sent him this paper that I wrote to get into Temple University. And he was very positive. He was very well established, had written like 14 books, was the top expert on Florida politics, was number four scientist in Florida, according to like this magazine that rates these things every year. But he sort of took me under his wing. And he told me that my paper was the best thing he'd read from a student, my writing sample, really, in 30 years as a professor. And that included doctoral projects. And so that was good, because I was really in total obscurity, pretty much. And I had somebody who believed in me and encouraged me. And that was really invaluable. I went to conferences with him. I enrolled at Temple University in a PhD program. And at some point, talking to Lance, he said, yeah, this SCAD theory that we've been working on, we're happy about it. It doesn't get much purchase because, the academy is very conservative, but we're at least doing this work. And he said, there's a problem. There's two weaknesses with the theory. There's no theory of the state in this state crimes against democracy theory. And there's no theory about the role of economic elites. And so I did more research and reading into how you might address these issues. And Peter Del Scott's work was huge in this regard. And so I borrowed a lot of his work, a lot of work from C. Wright Mills, and a lot of the things I'd learned from working with Lance and talking to Lance. And I set about doing a dissertation that was going to be very radical, and because I felt the extant scholarship was insufficient. And so that was how I went about trying to figure out another way that you could look at this in a scholarly sense. And at the same time, I also, when I finished 4 years of like taking coursework and stuff, then I went to teach high school to have a paycheck, because I figured I wasn't going to get foundation funding for this kind of a project. And that was actually a great experience in the classroom. The students in the classroom were great. And I taught U.S. history and East Asian history, and then a course on the American century with help from Peter Kuznick and Oliver Stone that dealt with films that related to American imperialism and the dark side of it all. And it was great to go back and look at history, even back in the 1700s, 1800s, to see how America developed. So all these things were, it was a paycheck, but it was also a great way to relearn this history and study it more. And then as fate would have it, I'm studying East Asian history, Chinese history, Japanese history at a time when Asia and the rise of China especially is becoming a huge issue. And so being, you know, spending 3 years teaching a year-long course on East Asian history, and most of that was devoted to China, that was also great preparation for understanding the moment that we're in now, geopolitically, and with China emerging again on the world stage. So all these things led me to eventually finish this book and draw from my experiences and so on to formulate a theory of the U.S. empire and the lawlessness to explain why we are where we are and all the problems that we have.
Yeah, I mean, your story is really interesting because oftentimes you have the opposite trajectory. You have someone who, when their youth is pretty radical and into revolutionary politics and student activism, and as they get involved in academia, they move further to the center and become a mainstream milquetoast Democrat. And they might still maintain a kind of radical veneer using radical sounding rhetoric in their research. But when it comes to their research interests, they almost never deviate from narratives that are convenient to the U.S. empire. So I think it's a really refreshing story. And it's also a sad story because it shows that, you know, you can be a good student and be a good academic, a good scholar, but if you're covering topics that you're not allowed to cover in academia, you're not going to be able to find, you know, at least in U.S. academia, you're not going to be able to find an institution that will support your research. But, you know, later on in these discussions, I think we are going to talk about the role of academia. You and your book discuss the role of academia and helping to create this kind of intellectual stanchion on which a lot of U.S. hegemony is built. But I really want to start this discussion at the most basic level. And one of the things I like about your book is that you begin in the first chapter establishing your terms, right? There, I think it was, it's often attributed to Socrates. He said, define your terms. And people have argued that many political debates are actually just arguments over definitions. And you begin your book very clearly articulating what your theses are and what your questions are. So I want to begin with the questions. Right at the beginning of your book, you say, this book and my dissertation and the research that I've done has been dedicated to trying to answer two specific questions. And this book is almost 400 pages, and you could say that it's a 400 page answer to these two questions. One, why does US foreign policy display such continuity across administrations? And then the other question, which is related, why has American democracy, and more specifically the rule of law in the United States, declined inversely with the rise of U.S. global dominance? Now, you provide three different what you call realms of analysis. Specifically, you analyze the rule of law in the United States, the levels of inequality that have grown and skyrocketed in the United States, and you also analyze what you call a decline in American nationalism. Although when you say nationalism, you don't mean it in the sense of like rah, 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 flag wagging nationalism. You describe it as economic nationalism, referring to the pursuit of policies which strengthen and enrich the country's collective economy and population. So you could say the collective well-being. So can you articulate, further articulate this outline that I spelled out here of the two questions that you posit, and then looking at these three different realms of U.S. policy in rule of law, inequality, and the decline of kind of collective nationalism, and what that has to do with your two fundamental questions about why foreign policy has remained so consistent and why the rule of law continues to decline as U.S. global dominance increases.
Right, and this is the challenge of doing this kind of a work, especially in political science, where the focus of inquiry is often very narrow and you're really looking for mid-range theory. I wasn't doing that, and it was so framing it, the way that you explain it, which was the way that I went about it, it seems straightforward, but it actually took a lot of like sort of strategizing on my part. Because I knew a lot of the story that I wanted to tell in the areas that I wanted to explore, but the constraints of political science and social science in the United States are such that I needed to frame this around some questions and problems that weren't, it wasn't really obvious which was the way to go with this. And, you know, so for the problems of political science and social science in the U.S., notwithstanding, that exercise was actually helpful to force me to boil it down to conform to those sort of norms in political science that I was going to frame things around these questions. And so, you know, framing it around why does foreign policy never change or change very minimally, regardless who gets elected, and why has democracy, the things that we could measure as far as representing, you know, positive developments and rule by the, you know, governmental rule by in that is helpful for the population. I mean, this is like the most basic stuff. Like, is the government actually advancing the common interests of the citizens? Like, why is this not happening? This is what you'd expect in a democracy. Why is it not happening? So these three areas are ways to look at this and the decline of the rule of law. So you have high criminality, which is high officials breaking the law, high crimes, as mentioned in the Constitution, high crimes and misdemeanors are grounds for impeachment. Well, we have a lot of crimes from people in high places that go unadjudicated in the government, and elite criminality as well. You have a realm of people, especially the financial collapses is really obvious. People who were guilty of crimes and made a lot of money, but were not prosecuted. Really nobody was prosecuted in relation to the financial collapse of 2008. And the basic degradation of constitutional rights that were supposed to have free speech, the right to assemble, freedom from unwarranted search and seizure, and all these things get whittled away at different times, and other rights of, like, you know, not being tortured and such. This also that goes on, and so this is a big problem. And the criminality aspect is most obvious in terms of the UN Charter. The U.S. in foreign policy, especially, is just totally lawless, and they've signed. It's not just that. There's this international law that nobody can enforce. The U.S. has signed the U.N. Charter and ratified it. And thus, according to the Supremacy Clause of the Constitution, it is the highest law in the land. But the U.S., the U.N. Charter stipulates or dictates that you are not to attack another country or threaten to attack another country. That aggression, international aggression, is illegal, is forbidden. The U.S. does that all the time, supreme law of the land, according to the Constitution, and it's just totally ignored, and there's no mechanism for stopping it. So this is serious. The inequality is a totally undemocratic thing. It's basically back to 1920s levels in the United States, and with this comes political inequality, because there's this Gillen-Page paper that came out a few years ago, maybe 6 years ago. And these are respectable political scientists at Princeton and Northwestern, and they found that the general public, the average voter, has essentially no impact on public policy in the United States. And so this is more or less empirical validation of what C. Wright Mills was saying in the 50s about the power elite and how they're making all the decisions, and that the rest of the country is just at a basic stalemate and neutralized. But here, now they do it with, like, statistical regression 60 years later, and it turns out C. Wright Mills was correct. So this is something serious. Why is there this level of inequality that people would not vote for these kind of policies and choose these in any sort of democratic system? That it just is ridiculous. And when I talk about nationalism as another part here, this is an interesting subject, because we associate this with, like, Nazis. And I think that this is kind of a product of the ruling powers in the United States, that we are reflexively thinking that nationalism is just bad. But we also know as leftists that, like, the U.S. hated nationalists, like Patrice Lumumba was a nationalist. Hugo Chavez was a nationalist. They were nationalists and internationalists, but those aren't mutually exclusive things. You expect leaders to want to uplift the people of their country, and they take on the cause of their country, and they identify as being a part of that country. And that's just what nationalism is. So it's interesting that there's a certain kind of leftist who would be like, no, we are the part of that. We have class consciousness and we hate nationalism, full stop. But that clashes with a lot of the people that that have been prominent leftists. You know, I mean, when you are Salvador Allende, what do you do with your country's copper? You nationalize it. You don't turn it over to some proletariat revolution, the international, because there's no such thing. So national, and if you read like the Trilateral Commission's reports in the 70s, you know, this is like the sort of hive mind of capitalism that kind of replaces the CFR in some ways as the U.S. becomes more financially based and into international commerce and structural dominance instead of just military dominance. The Trilateral Commission reports say nationalism is the enemy. So if the pinnacle of capitalism is saying nationalism is the enemy, then it seems like leftists should have a more nuanced view about nationalism. And I wanted to look at how nationalism has declined in the U.S. Namely, we're cool with having with lower economic growth and life expectancy shrinking and deindustrialization, infrastructure crumbling, massive levels of public and private debt that the state could negate or erase. And privatization of everything. This is not what you would expect in a democracy for people to vote for, like education to be turned into a profit center, for example.
Yeah, I did want to just say really quickly that this is a debate that goes back, you know, 100 years back to the Second International. And Lenin wrote a lot about the national question, and the position of what became the International Communist Movement was always that nationalism among oppressed nations is a progressive force. It's nationalism within imperialist nations, within imperialist powers, that is a reactionary force. We can see that clearly, you know, a progressive nationalism in Algeria, and you mentioned Congo and Patricio Lumumba, Venezuela, as opposed to, you know, German nationalism, French nationalism, or U.S. nationalism. So I think we do have to kind of distinguish those definitions of nationalisms. And when I was reading your book, I liked that you clarified that when you say nationalism, you're really talking about economic nationalism. And that's a term sometimes people use, which basically means that the policies of the government should be policies that act on behalf of the collective well-being of the people of the nation, and especially the resources of the country. Often economic nationalism is used to refer to like the policies of Mossadegh or even the current Iranian government, which clearly is not a socialist government, but it has economic nationalist policies. The current Russian government has economic nationalist policies. But yeah, that's a good question to ask. Why is it that in this age of neoliberal financial capital, the ruling class made the assessment that economic nationalism is our enemy? Because, of course, they want all capital to be internationalized and financialized.
Yeah, I mean, the simplest formulation, and I'm sure that China does not, and no nation has perfectly adhered to this. But when China talks about, hey, we want to have win-win relationships with other countries, I think that the two wins reflect kind of what I'm getting at in a theory here, which is they want policies that are good for China because they are Chinese nationalists, but they are internationalists, meaning they don't want, in theory, China's prosperity to be based on a zero-sum game where they're screwing over other countries. So This is a way to think of the nationalist being not in opposition to internationalism in theory, and it's something important to hash out. So this is not what you'd expect from a democracy. I mean, American leaders, even if they don't practice economic nationalism, but they walk around with little flag lapels and talk about how exceptional we are. So it's not like they're not nationalists in that sense. They're just not nationalists in a meaningful sense in terms of like the whole nation as this group of people that identify as being American.
And a lot of the time, the way that the state gets looked at as needing this like coherent political ideology ignores how like opportunistic that becomes, because it's not necessarily, it is self-interested, but it's not always in the self-interest of the nation as a whole, which is a big part of the neoliberal turn, is that you have Thatcher and Reagan very much undermining and deindustrializing in a way that, as you talk about, the rise in public and private debt and in privatizing the commons and trying to internalize into markets any part of private or personal life, is this, I think you call it like a quote, unproductive and feudalizing dynamic. And it creates rentier capital out of everything that used to be in some way shared amongst each other. And that tends to, it's sort of a victim of its own success, because the empire, as you talk about, this is all in the context of unipolar empire. And as Ben can speak to, we might be reaching a new era where that might not be the case. And so as that sort of, these dynamics play out as a result of how successful the empire has been, to the point where transnational, smooth capital across international borders can sort of take on a life of its own and dominate the political space domestically. Is the bill coming due for elite criminality, as it were? Because you spent a lot of time talking through that. In the unipolar context, there has never been a challenge that might make that bill come due. But is it starting to reach that point, or is there, as an alternative, are we going to see a dawn of a new era of more maybe desperate or hyper elite criminality coming out of the unipolar era?
That is the big question, is where are the American elites going at this point in time? Where does the regime see itself headed as this unipolar moment of American dominance, which has been the case since the end of the Cold War? It is unstable and it is declining. And so it's created enormous contradictions in the U.S. and around the world. And it seems to be fragmenting away at an alarming rate. Even Europe, you have to wonder how long Europe can remain an American neo-colony, which I really don't think it's that much of an exaggeration to describe the EU in those terms. They're being forced to pursue policies that are very counter to their own self-interests on the pretext of some kind of idea of Western civilization led by the U.S. But what's worth defending even with that is becoming harder to imagine, because they're clearly in a subservient status to the United States. But the United States is a bit of a mess. Joe Biden, I don't think, is perceived as a great statesman leading a noble project by a lot of people. And before that, you had Trump, and that his election alone demands some deep investigation of just what has happened to the United States. And so this is the question: what is going to happen with this regime, and how are, you know, the dominance that has allowed it to get away with such crimes for so long, as that dominance fades, what is going to be the consequence of that when the underlying material situation, which has allowed it to sit to tell so much of the world and its own population how it's going to be, when that dominance is gone, then what will happen, or what will they do to stop that reckoning? This is the one of the big questions of our time.
Yeah, and I frequently point out, empires commit their worst atrocities when they're in these moments of decline and crisis. The most clear example of that is the German Empire, right? Like, people used to talk about the German Empire. What happened? Well, the German Empire was destroyed in World War II. The German Empire culminated in the Third Reich and Nazi Germany. Also, the Ottoman Empire culminated in the genocide against Armenians and Greeks and Assyrians. The British Empire with these, it kind of collapsed and was destroyed in World War II, but we saw genocide in the Indian subcontinent with the Bengal famine. And I mean, these horrific atrocities, the French Empire with these borderline genocidal policies in Algeria, like these scorched earth campaigns. Is the U.S. going to do something similar? Or is it going to go out with a bang? I hope not, but all the indications seem to suggest that you have these hawks in Washington whose solution to every conflict is to pour more fuel on the fire, send more weapons to Ukraine, accelerate the war with Russia, call for a war with China over Taiwan, invoke the Monroe Doctrine. I mean, I'm scared that in the upcoming decades, as we see the decline of U.S. unipolarity and the rise of China, that the U.S. is going to be extremely aggressive and try to assert control over Latin America. And we see more and more U.S. politicians invoke the Monroe Doctrine, which has its 200th anniversary next year. This is a 200-year-old colonial doctrine, predating even abolition of slavery. So I think that's the fundamental question. But, we could spend a lot of time talking about this. This is something that, I cover a lot. But I do want to advance a little bit and talk about the tripartite state and how that relates. It's very much related to the creation of this American unipolar order. You note in your book that this analysis is not necessarily new. Back in the 1950s, C. Wright Mills, and you could talk about who this is, this was a progressive, you know, social democratic, left-leaning sociologist who was influential in the kind of new left. My understanding is he wasn't really like a revolutionary Marxist, but he was definitely very progressive. And C. Wright Mills, he analyzed back in the 50s, the decline in democracy in the United States. And he articulated a tripartite structure that had weakened democracy, and the three centers of power in the United States, according to C. Wright Mills' analysis, were big business, the military, and the political class. And you take a similar analysis for your argument of the tripartite state, whereas C. Wright Mills had argued that it was big business, the military, and the political class. You say the public state, that is the political state, you know, the bourgeois democracy, the security state, which is related to the military, you know, you could talk about what the security state is, and also the deep state. Now, the deep state is closely related to big business that C. Wright Mills spoke about, but your argument about what the deep state is a little different, and it includes elements of this criminality that we were discussing. So talk about the tripartite state and how this created the very form of U.S. unipolarity that we were just discussing, because we can't understand how we got to where we are now of the moment of decline of U.S. unipolarity without understanding how that unipolar order was constructed in the first place. And you argue, I think correctly, that the structure of that unipolarity is based on this tripartite model.
Yeah, Mills was a very brilliant sociologist, the best sociologist of the post-war era, probably the best social scientist who is notable for being a social scientist. I mean, I think Peter Dale Scott really built on his work, and Mills died very young. I have a suspicion that he may have been poisoned. I recall reading years ago that he fell kind of ill at a debate over Cuba, and that his health deteriorated after that, and he died in his in his 40s. And when I look back at how brilliant he was and how he was sticking up for the Cuban Revolution, and how he died before Kennedy was assassinated, even though he basically predicted the Cuban Missile Crisis very well in his book, The Causes of World War III, which was maybe his last work, or his one of the last anyway. It was like a semi-follow-up to The Power Elite. But his work just dealt with the power structure of the United States and how there wasn't much democracy. And we'll talk about him more in a later chapter, so I'm not going to go too deep into him now. But he wrote about the big three institutions, and he said that they're really interchangeable at the top, and that this combined with the corporate mode of economic organization that initially emerged after the Civil War during the Gilded Age, and really rose in America to dominate economic life, that it had become so powerful that it swept away the New Deal institutions such as they were, and that really big decisions were made in smaller and smaller circles. And we're not even really privy to how they get made and who is making them and on what basis anymore. And this is kind of a crisis if you believe in any sort of democracy. His own politics were hard to pigeonhole because he's a materialist in his analysis. I mean, he sees economic organization driving things, but he's more sophisticated than generic Marxists. And so I think he occupies... I think a real evolution of what Marx was getting at, if you ask me. I think that he represents something that is a better level of analysis than some of the people who stick to strict Marxism, because, people like Parenti or people like Peter Dale Scott, even people like Susan Strange, you have structure, which Marxism, doctrinaire Marxism does structure pretty well, but you also have the agency given to certain actors because of the structure of the system and the class structure. And so this is what Mills was trying to get at, and other people have built on that too. He actually said, "I'm a wobbly when it comes down to it," meaning I'm a left anarchist which is a way of saying I'm a kind of a Marxist who is, you know, of the anarchist variety, which when you look at what he was influenced by, because he wrote The Power Elite because he had read Franz Neumann's book Behemoth about the rise of Nazi Germany and how you could have the rise of this fascistic state in an advanced industrialized nation state. And so he was alarmed by this, and he thought that something like that could happen in the United States. And that motivated him to write The Power Elite, that this top-down power was becoming institutionalized and predominating in American life. And so that was the direction that he went in. And so I, looking at that and thinking of being steeped in Mills as I was, and reading Peter Del Scott, and Ola Tenander is another guy who wrote about the state. They go back and try to look at the dual state and the deep state. And Peter, before he started writing about the deep state, wrote about the deep political system, which was that, okay, you know, you have the military and the police and so on in the United States. You have democracy, but then you also have the power of elites. And they're often intertwined with shady economies like drug dealing, you know, opium, especially in New England. All those fortunes, early capitalist fortunes in America, came oftentimes from opium and from the slave trade. And so this is, so America from the beginning was, you know, a capitalist enterprise. The Virginia Company in Jamestown, the Massachusetts Bay Company in Boston, brought on by the enclosure movement in England, which sets off British imperialism and really is modern capitalism. People will say capitalism originated in, you know, Venice and other places. These were more like merchants and trading entities that operated that way. Even the Netherlands, when they were really powerful, it was a slightly different kind of operation than the British. And even the Spanish were more like crudely plundering places rather than this kind of more commercialized corporate imperialism, which colonized North America for the English and allowed vast fortunes to be made, especially in opium and the slave trade. And so that's where America always had this sort of deep, darker power that was private power. It was private power. Private power becomes a part of the regime, and I needed a way to incorporate that.
Yeah, Aaron, I want you to be able to continue that thought there. I just wanted to jump in really quickly and point out that this is such a key detail to keep in mind in terms of understanding not only the history of capitalism, but understanding more specifically the history of imperialism and how inextricably linked capital has always been to the state since the emergence of capitalism, which of course happens around the same time of the emergence of European colonialism in the Americas and not just in the Americas, but with the point you just made is so crucial because it inoculates people to this like Ron Paul libertarian idea of corporatism, right? They always talk about crony capitalism and corporatism. They say the problem isn't capitalism, the problem is corporatism. But from the very origins of capitalism, capital has always been directly linked with the state and with organized crime. And you can go back to the Dutch East India Company, the East India Trading Company, Britain's version. I mean, capital and of course the companies you named that were the companies that founded the modern day United States. You know, these were colonial companies that were ultimately seeking profits. They weren't just doing it to spread the white man's burden. And in many ways, that kind of liberal idea that colonialism was motivated by pure white supremacy and the civilizational idea of spreading Christianity or whatever. No, colonialism was to steal the resources and also labor through slavery of these countries that were being colonized. It wasn't because they wanted to spread Christianity. That was the justification ideologically used. And white supremacy was created as the justification for that colonial plunder. But if we don't understand that history, which we can't understand the history of the United States or European colonialism without, then people get lost. And it makes sense that, you know, you have like this New York Times understanding of white supremacy, which is all purely motivated by racial animus, ignoring the fact that why was white supremacy created? It was created to justify the enslavement of African peoples. Like, they didn't just enslave African people because they thought African people were inferior. They enslaved African people because they needed to, they didn't need to, they wanted to exploit their labor. Their entire economy was built on exploiting their labor, the slave economy, the slaveocracy, and then they justified it through the creation of racism and white supremacy. So again, this is also the difference between a liberal analysis of history and a materialist analysis. And I think that's also why your perspective is so important, and why I really appreciate your book, because it actually has a materialist understanding of how we got to where we are, which isn't rooted in like these popular liberal tropes that we hear today.
Yeah, liberal or libertarian, as you point out, the libertarians want to say they really worship capitalism. So it kind of is a question of first principles. And liberals and libertarians both share a belief that capitalism is great and replacing it is bad. And any sort of theory that rests upon a fundamental critique of capitalism must be also be bad. And so this is a problem with the libertarian point of view. They want to worship a capitalism that never existed. There was never a capitalism that was benevolent and consensual and free, you know, commerce among people. You had the closing off of the commons, which was really the depriving of people in under feudalism of the one sort of thing that they had, which was the commons to be able to sustain themselves. And that created pressures for especially the English to go and colonize other places to do things similar to what they were doing to their own territory, you know, walling off land to produce products for a market economy. So the first place they went was Ireland, and they brutalized people over there, like Sir Humphrey Gilbert of the British brutalized the Irish, and they came up with all this racist mythology about Ireland and how they even tried to say Irish people were actually descended from Africans, not the white people that the British were descended from. And then the I think half brother of Sir Humphrey Gilbert, who suppressed the Irish, he was Sir Walter Raleigh, and he wanted to colonize North America. And there were actually policy papers from like the British equivalent of like the British like 1500s equivalent of like the Council on Foreign Relations, people writing about how the empty space in North America could be a pressure valve to relieve overcrowding at home and really help the ruling class in England by decreasing these population pressures. And this is the basis for American colonialism. It's an economic basis to A, get out of England, B, go set up some business enterprises over in this nice unspoiled land, you know, provided that you kill the people first. And so the white supremacy of the racial part of it for Ireland is made to justify conquest. And the same thing is applied to the American Indians that they encounter. And it's justifies, quote unquote, the expropriation of these people and, you know, their kind of genocide, often through microbes. So it's like that accident of history allows the Westerners or the Europeans to sort of feel like they're not quite as responsible, since a big part of it was done by, you know, viruses and stuff that they had no defense against. But of course, there's a lot of just deliberate taking of land and ripoffs and so on. And for
and smallpox blankets. I mean, intentionally, yes, infecting people.
Yeah, but most of the time, just by showing up, they did it as good a job as they could have with their chicanery. They did. They eventually become so conscious of it that they do it on purpose, which is, of course, totally morally reprehensible and, you know, horrible crime. And if there's a hell, you know, yada yada. But the liberty, fast forward to today, and as you were talking about the New York Times and liberals, and I don't know if you said the 1619 Project specifically, but
what I was referencing, yeah.
Devious, because they say like 1619, they actually back away from this and become kind of weaker about it because they were scrutinized by so many historians about this as it being bad history. But they want to say that the founding of the U.S. is 1619, the real founding, because that's when the slaves show up. And that is an important event in U.S. history, but it has to be understood. Like, first of all, if you're going to say when the United States began and you want to frame it around slavery, then that is automatically saying that, like, the problems are related to race and racism. When really the United States began as a corporate venture, and that's very obvious. If you're talking about slavery, then you're not talking about the Massachusetts Bay Company and the Virginia Company. And that was really how it began. Now, slavery comes about, as you mentioned, they wanted to exploit African labor. The main point that I would add to that is that they didn't want to do that. Really, there weren't that many slaves English North America, until after around 1675, 1676, the Bacon's Rebellion, where these white poor whites who had been indentured servants rose up against the colonial government in Virginia, and they sacked Jamestown and burned it. And they wanted land that they were promised, but the wealthy had taken all the good land. And so the people who had actually survived their indentures, they demanded what was owed to them, which was land. But the only land was on, the only still good land that was out there was inhabited by Indians. And the British didn't want to fight expensive wars with them, because at the same time you had King Philip's War in Massachusetts, and that was very expensive and put those colonies into debt. So the British were walking a fine line between wanting to colonize and have these this profitable land for whatever purpose, but not wanting to go into debt for it. And so this created a problem. How do you, this labor force, is they need to be armed because of the Indians and so on. Like, how are you going to deal with these problems of poor whites who want more land and might actually get more power? And the way they deal with it is slavery. They start using a lot more African slaves, and they become a perceived as a fundamentally a different kind of human, not even really fully human, in the South, in order to justify the institution of slavery, and but for the purposes of maintaining the hegemony of the dominant planter class in the South. And this is really the basis of American racism, and why racism is so salient and powerful in the US is because it's backed by the economic interests and the hegemony of the ruling elite. And so racism exists for this reason, and it becomes so powerful and entrenched in American culture because of that. And that is the key fact that the 1619 Project wants to obscure. Instead, they want to make it as like, oh, it's just racist, and these people did this because they were racist, and they've been racist for a long time, and we need to combat this racism, and it's going to be a long task, so we're probably never going to really ever totally do it. We'll just keep working at it, trying to solve this problem, which, of course, is never going to be solved.
By electing Biden.
By voting Democrat. And so this is anything to avoid looking at capitalism as the heart of the problem, and this sort of fundamental exploitation that is baked into the cake of capitalism and imperialism, because from its birth, it was, you know, exploitation is a part of civilization that predates capitalism, obviously, but capitalism takes it to a new stage, and it kind of makes it the basis for organizing society around economic activity and exploitation. And it's always been hand in hand with imperialism. And that's something people have to recognize if you really want to get to the root of our problems. So this is really important, and I'm glad you focus on that aspect.
Yeah, there's a really good book about this by the Field Sisters, Racecraft. And there's also another really good book, Invention of the White Race by Theodore Allen, for people who are interested in a kind of a materialist analysis of racism and white supremacy. But go ahead, Seamus.
Yeah, I think we're hitting on something really, important here in terms of the racial dimension coming out of some of that early sort of capitalist expansion and everything. I mean, there's also sort of an ideological aspect as to how liberalism can fancy itself more progressive today while also justifying all kinds of atrocities at that point in time. And I would point out something that, Ben, you were pointing out some of the parallels or there's this continuity in terms of the European colonial empires and then American, but we have this internal sense of distance from the British Empire I think it goes beyond just the fact that we got our independence from them. And so we want to separate our nature from theirs towards something else where, like, the American political imagination is centered around more of a parallel with Rome. Like, I think a lot of people tend to think of us as more paralleled with the Roman Empire and not European colonialism. And there's plenty of material parallels there, but our imagination is divorced from that for a reason. And I think it's given us a lot of power, at least prior to the full sort of our claiming full hegemony post-World War II, we were able to play on the anti-colonial story a lot where, we sort of could act as the prime example of what you could do when you got out from under the thumb of colonialism and sort of play act as that anti-imperial power. And that gets at something at the core of liberalism again, that there's not just that sort of narrative power there, but there's a supposed neutrality that comes about out of that, where it's like specifically, we're going to talk more about the financial aspect of the empire, I'm sure. But the idea, there's nowhere that it's more clear that American imperialism is always, it's never been in the same way that it was like for the British. It's bringing the crown to the corners of the earth and pushing the crown. It's always been like the Romans. It's in the interest of the Senate and the imperium, the people. And we always do that for Americans. We went into Iraq because it's about Americans' interests and keeping them, quote unquote, safe, or their gas prices down, and whatever you wanted to go with as an explanation. It's always used under the guise of the interests of the people, which, as we've talked about, it tends to backfire and it's coming home. But specifically, the financial structure of the empire has allowed a sort of the spread of an idea of the neutral rules of the game that is sitting at the core of it. I'm sure we'll talk more about liberalism too, but there's a false sense of neutrality as to the financial rules of the game, where all the institutions, the IMF and the World Bank, are supposedly neutral, and they're not explicitly under US control, when in reality the entire thing is built to have capital flows come back to the US. And even in the neocolonial era, it works the exact same way, where we're able to hide the explicit colonial relations that the European powers had, but we're still able to get it to function in the same way and hide behind a lot of that ideology that obscures the way that the power relation actually plays out. And that allows us to tell ourselves this story that we're more like the Romans and not like the British, for example.
Yeah, the U.S. was full of kind of Anglophiles in the establishment, but they were influenced a bit by the Romans with the Senate, you know, having it called the Senate. But England itself, with the England sort of sees itself as the heir, and then the U.S. later, although less self-consciously, England saw itself as the heir to Western civilization. And so they embraced the Greeks, embraced the Romans, and so on. The British system was, in theory, modeled on aspects of, like, taken from like Aristotle's Politics and his different kinds of government. So the crown was supposed to represent monarchy, which was one of the forms of government. The House of Lords was supposed to represent like oligarchy, and the House of Commons was supposed to represent democracy. And so this was, in theory, this is how the English sort of presented themselves as this great inheritor of Western civilization, and then creating a synthesis of its best political elements, and then, which of course, you know, proceeds to have an empire that covers, you know, well, like the sun never sets on, supposedly. So this was it. And what happens in Britain is similar to what happens in the U.S. that you have a change where the visible parts of the government are less decisive, and other parts are more decisive. And that is, you know, parts of that come to the fore in the theory of the tripartite state in the United States. That was where I was trying to go with that. And as Ben pointed out, the public state is pretty easy to understand and being analogous to Mill's, politicians, you know, the political directorate as one of the big three, and a security state is which he also calls the warlords. That's your national security state. And when he talks about big business, I see that as being, in a way, the power that animates what I call the deep state, which is not to say that it is something you can, it's more abstract and nebulous, but it is not something that you can purely say comes from the public state. It's not something that you can say is here, we've identified it in the national security state, and it's not coming from something in civil society that is somehow walled off from the rest of the state or the regime, whatever you want to call it. And so, you know, if you wanted to say as a synecdoche, capitalism is the deep state, that's not the worst thing you could say. But of course, I try to go on and hash this out more definitively in the book to try to explain what I mean. And when it comes to the deep state, I have a broad, inclusive understanding of it, in that it can mean, I can say the deep state and really mean more or less what people mean when they say the establishment, like that set of interests and institutions and individuals that rule by means of private agreement rather than, you know, democratic means. Like that's what we think of when we think of the establishment, and in a way the deep state could be thought of that way. So you could think of these institutions that are that wield power, but in less obvious ways than like Congress, you know, like the Council on Foreign Relations, you can say is part of the deep state, or these foundations that influence academia and the so-called independent media, they can be considered part of the deep state. Or you can use the deep state to really mean, and this is the meaning that's taken from the Turkish version of the deep state, where it really is this clandestine network, where you're talking about the most opaque, secretive, lawless parts of the actual government. And then, so the deep state can refer to those as well. And I don't see a big contradiction in like having it be applicable both ways, because ultimately what we're talking about is a system of top-down governance disguised with a democratic veneer. And the public state is the veneer, and the security state protects the status quo, but the deep state really sets the agenda in both of them, and deep political power, the power of private wealth especially, really heavily influences, really dominates the public state, that is electoral politics, but it also shaped the way that the national security state was formed and organized after World War II, you know, the way that you're going to have this National Security Council, the Joint Chiefs, the Central Intelligence Agency, eventually the NSA. All of these were done with decisive input from the super rich and the emissaries of the super rich. And so you can't just look at it as being a security state designed to safeguard the constitutional government. Like, it's actually safeguarding a lot more, including the existing oligarchy of private wealth. And so this is what the tripartite state exists in a dictatorship that's an outright dictatorship. You don't need a deep state because the public face of the state is the same as the deep state and the security state, right? But in a nominal democracy, things are done covertly, and therefore you end up with this tripartite structure, I think, especially if you're managing the empire, then you're going to have your visible security state, your visible political decision makers, public officials, and you're going to have the establishment that every new person in the military and the political directorate has to deal with, and that involves making sure that your policy prescriptions and appointments are satisfactory in the eyes of the richest and most powerful people and interests in the United States.
Yeah, and I think you really summarize it well when you say that the institutions that exercise undemocratic power over state and society collectively comprise the deep state. So you say the deep state is an outgrowth of the overworld of private wealth. And maybe you can describe what you mean by it when you say overworld and underworld. But I think for me that's a really good way of describing it, because what it really is when you have an empire, when you have a capitalist society, but especially when you have a global spanning empire, you have to carry out these illegal actions, these criminal actions, in order to maintain your hegemony, to maintain your power. Assassinations, coups, rigging elections, etc. The deep state is where that activity happens, is where that activity is organized. Well, you have the political state that maintains this, veneer of democracy and the rule of law. In order to maintain that illusion of democracy and rule of law, you have to have behind the scenes the deep state. At least if you want to maintain a global spanning capitalist empire, you need to have that dirty work that happens behind the scenes. And you say it very well again here in your book that the dominance of the deep state has diminished U.S. democracy to such an extent that it's justified to describe ours as a deep state system. So you argue that the deep state, because this criminal activity has become so important to maintaining the stability of this US empire, and we see now it's spiraling out of control and that criminality is also spiraling out of control, that has actually removed any semblance of democracy from the system. And then you add that you call this covert lawlessness. This covert lawlessness with which the U.S. pursued international dominance after World War II had the cumulative effect of transforming an imperfect democracy, a very imperfect democracy, into a tripartite state system characterized by covert top-down rule. So, I mean, maybe you can further explain what you mean by that. And then, of course, also what the overworld and underworld are.
Right. The overworld and underworld, I take the term overworld from Peter Duff Scott used it. I didn't really know. I hadn't heard that term too much in my life and before reading Peter, except for video games. I think Zelda, they refer to the overworld where you walk around before you like go into the dungeons, right? But that's not what Peter's talking about. He's talking about the higher levels of the political economic elite, private wealth. So people like the Rockefellers, the Morgans, other very wealthy people that would be in a position to influence policy. So the super rich and the people that serve them. So, you know, like William Randolph Hearst would be, you know, a part of this. And then some of the people that are known that are more flamboyant might not even be really the more important people. I think that it's quite possible that much of the class structure in the U.S. is opaque by design, and that because they control the legislative process and they can create the legal frameworks for foundations and so on and holding companies, we may not actually know who some of the most important people are. And people like Bezos or Bill Gates or Elon Musk, they may actually function in a way as kind of like a cover story for like the rotating winner of capitalism, because you have to wonder when, at what point did the overworld of like Rockefeller Oil, you know, Standard Oil and JP Morgan, when they, when Chase Manhattan, you know, was also a Rockefeller company, like when did they, or the, did Rockefeller, Freeport Sulfur, Freeport McMoRan, that's what, those are Rockefeller companies. Like when did they ever, when did their investments ever not become super lucrative? When did they ever stop accumulating more and more wealth is an open question. But the overworld and the underworld of organized crime, so the overworld of private wealth, which Peter Del Scott really goes into better than anyone else in this area, and the underworld of organized crime, they're more related than is typically recognized. It's common in sort of generic liberal understandings to see like the government and society and the economy kind of working about like they tell you in civics classes and whatever, and when you're growing up and going to American high schools and whatever, that it's like basically above board, and that there's this organized crime stuff, and if it becomes a big enough problem, then it becomes like something you could call corruption and so on. But it's not that organized crime and the underworld of organized crime is something outside of the system that is a problem. It's that it's always there. And it's another word for organized crime is tolerated crime. And so in a place like Chicago, for example, through the 30s, there were thousands and thousands of unsolved murders that you knew were never going to be solved because the authorities were so corrupted by organized crime and crime syndicates that they were a part of the system of governance. And in the U.S., as far as imperialism goes, I mean, they create all these lawless actors to police the Cold War, you know, and do the things in the night to protect us from communism or whatever. And it's like that's when you get institutionalized, these covert action policies, and also the cover story element becomes institutionalized as well, where the government's going to do something gangsterish and it's going to create a built-in story that's going to be the pretend story to explain what happened. And that it wasn't just the U.S. doing gangster business, but it was like something else happened. It was a public uprising to overthrow a ruler or whatever. You know, that gets institutionalized. But the basic contours of that were in existence in the U.S. before the Cold War. And in Latin America, it's the most obvious. So in Honduras, around 1912, if I recall correctly, you have Sam Zemurray, who went down to Honduras with Machine Gun Maloney and Lee Christmas. Machine Gun Maloney was a mobster, as you might guess, and Lee Christmas, who was a soldier of fortune, and then they bribed some Honduran officials, and they basically overthrew the government of Honduras because Honduras was looking to make the banana company pay its fair share on taxes on land that it owned there, because they go down and buy up all the land, you have all these peasants who can't really do anything but farm, but they don't have any land, horrible for Latin America. I mean, you understand this basic dynamic because you're in Nicaragua. I'm sure you know this well. But the key is, like, think about what Seamus Murray did. He got in a boat from New Orleans, sailed down to Honduras with a mercenary and a gangster and some and bought off officials, and he just overthrew a government, which is just what the CIA would do later. Okay. And he didn't do it because of global communist conspiracy. He did it to advance his own economic interests. And this is a kind of like imperialism, but carried out without government sanction at this point. It would have violated like the neutrality acts and other things. Not that these people often got prosecuted for that, but in theory they could, and some people actually did. But in the Cold War, this kind of thing gets institutionalized and brought into the state. And so even still, maybe you'd still want to say that, well, it was anti-communism that was the justification for this. It was really, you got to protect, you can't let communists encroach. It's just bad news. They're threatening the American way of life. But then after the Cold War, does the policy change? You know, and the answer is no. Like
it intensifies.
George Bush the first overthrows Aristide using paramilitary people connected to the drug traffic. And then George W. Bush overthrows Aristide again, using also drug connected assets, like staging a fake invasion from Dominican Republic. And I believe the guy involved in the 2004 Aristide coup eventually came out and said, like, yeah, the CIA was putting me up to this. But the end result was the CIA, the U.S. forced Aristide at gunpoint to resign, and they kidnapped him and took him to Africa. Right. And so this is after the Cold War. They try to overthrow Chavez and they fail in like 2002. They've had these operations against Nicaragua in recent years and Venezuela. And there's no Cold War fig leaf to explain these away. And so if they were doing this kind of stuff before the Cold War and they were doing it after the Cold War, of course they were doing it during the Cold War. Well, the explanation has to be something bigger and deeper than the exigencies of the Cold War itself. And that needs an explanation, and it needs an understanding of how it gets brought into the state. And so the deep political system that existed before World War II, which you could definitely see Seamus Murray and his 1913 coup as being emblematic of the deep political system, with the creation of the CIA and the launching of the Cold War, all taking the gloves off to fight communism, and justifying any measures taken to subvert the communist conspiracy, you have these elements brought into the state and made a part of the regime, and made much more powerful. And that is basically the emergence of the tripartite state.
So we're going to take a pause there. That was the end of part one of the Empire and Deep State series that I, Ben Norton, and Multipolarista, am co-hosting with Aaron Good of the American Exception podcast. Please check out future episodes. There will be a video and podcast version of this available. And if you subscribe at patreon.com/multipolarista and or patreon.com/American Exception, you can get early access to all of these episodes in both podcast and video form. So we'll see you in part two. Thanks a lot for watching or listening.